When I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my
Good morning, ladies. Thank you, Santi, for that very uplifting number. Truly, there is no one like our God. And your worship song, your praise song, just sets the pace for this morning's message. And let me begin with a disclaimer. Portions of this message picks up from the worldview discourse that Attorney Malou introduced at the beginning of this series. However, the emphasis will be on the impact of these human worldviews on science and reason as a way of answering the question on whether these are compatible with faith and Christian faith. Now, for purposes of this message also, I will refer to Christian faith as religion for simplicity of delivery, and because also most of the materials I used, that I researched on, uses this word to allude to Christianity. I've also used Encyclopedia Britannica as one of the main references to the definitions and historical accounts covered here, so that I can present an unbiased recorded evidence that anyone, regardless of his worldview, can refer to. So let us now begin with a word of prayer. Lord, thank you that in the course of this preparation, you ascertained to me that there's no one like you. Not even man in all his glory can measure up to who you are, our divine creator, from whence all things and everything began. So now, Father, please fill the gaps of my inadequacy, especially in the parts where I speak of your infinite greatness. And this I pray in the loving name of Jesus. Amen. So we will follow this three-point outline. First, define what are reason, science, and religion. And then the second part is trace the path of conflict between the first two against religion, if there's any. And then part three is answering exactly this question and whether there really is a conflict or if these three were compatible with each other. So let us begin with reason, which I have to say we will review or we will define in the context of its historical development. It is very hard to separate reason from history and the pathway of which it actually evolved. So according to Immanuel Kant, hailed as one of the greatest philosophers of all time, reason is a power of synthesizing into unity by means of comprehensive principles, the concepts that are provided by the intellect. It is said that he sharply criticized another famed philosopher's concept of being by charging that the so-called argument which would prove the existence of God by logic alone is misleading because this confuses existence with the nature or attribute of what is existing. When these two are disparate concepts and that one is not a property or a quality of the other. Now in theology, the Latin word for the study of God, logi meaning study, logos, and theo in reference to God. So reason is defined and as distinguished from faith as the human intelligence exercised upon religious truth, whether by way of discovery or by way of explanation. In Christian parlance, it is the human faculty or intelligence to exercise our free will. The powers and uses of reason had first been explored by the philosophers of ancient Greece. The Romans adopted and preserved much of Greek culture, notably including the ideas of a rational, natural order, and natural law. However, amid the wars, the conquests, the turmoil of empire, new concern arose for personal salvation, which paved the way for Christian religion. Fast forward, Christian thinkers in the 13th century after death of Christ, Anno Domini, AD, gradually found uses for this Greco-Roman heritage. The system of thought which culminated the work of Thomas Aquinas resurrected reason as a tool of understanding. In his presentation, Sir Thomas Aquinas used Aristotle's method for obtaining truth which was determined by reason alone. However, he stated that since Christian revelation contained a higher truth, he placed the natural law evident to reason subordinate to, but not in conflict with eternal and divine law. Now, After that, during the mid-13th and 14th centuries, a new system of education and mode of inquiry emerged, now known as humanism, which placed central emphasis on the human realm. Also known as Renaissance humanism, this new mode of inquiry was so profoundly influential that it is one of the chief reasons why the Renaissance, which also means rebirth, revival, reawakening, is viewed as a distinct historical period, a period known for being humanistic in origin. It was considered revolutionary because the Renaissance promoted a community founded on shared awareness and individual initiative, particularly at a time when ecclesiastical authority was as powerful, if not more powerful, than the abusive feudal system of society. Its attributed founder, Brunetto Latini, is credited for this humanistic revolution, which promoted civil liberties and eventually ignited the need for change in the tenets of faith in the universal church then that gave rise to the Christian Reformation. After the Renaissance, humanism continued on its influence in the Age of Enlightenment and today's modern democratic state. To it is also owed the rise of modern social science, which emerged not as an academic discipline, but rather as a practical instrument of social inquiry. Humanism, when balanced with a supernatural view of God, did not aim to remake humanity, but rather aimed to reform a chaotic social order through an understanding of what was basically and inalienably human. However, and I say this with emphasis, contrary to the good that humanism brought in terms of reforms in a chaotic social order, there were many notable humanists in the Age of Enlightenment and other parts of recorded history after the Renaissance who were non-religious. Men who believed that this life is the only life we have, that the universe is a natural phenomenon with no supernatural side, and that we can live ethical and fulfilling lives on the basis of reason and humanity. They have trusted to the scientific method, evidence, and reason to discover truths about the universe and have placed human welfare and happiness at the center of their ethical decision-making. These men applied reason to religion, and the outcome were conflicting worldviews. To my mind, actually, the outcome was disastrous. But anyway, let's be objective about this. The conflicting worldviews that was a byproduct of this application of reason to religion was one, in religion itself, was deism, which had very few religious truths felt to be manifest in all rational beings. It promoted the existence of one God conceived either as an architect or a mechanic. Beyond the natural religion, deism emerged more radical byproducts of applying reason to religion. And what were these? Skepticism, atheism, and materialism, two of which were covered by Attorney Malou in her discourse on worldviews. So, key words so far on reason. It is human intellect exercised in synthesizing knowledge. It is human intellect used in exercising free will. And this reason is a key tool to understanding. Okay, so let us now go to what science is. Science is any system of knowledge that is concerned with the physical world, covering general truths or the operations of fundamental laws, natural laws, through unbiased observations and systematic experimentation. The Science Council, a membership organization for professional bodies and learned societies across science, defines science as the pursuit of and application of knowledge and understanding of the natural and social world following a systematic methodology based on evidence. To illustrate this point, did you ever conduct an experiment as a young student, which you also witnessed repeated by your own child at that age, and then marveled at how both of you got the same results? One such experiment that is deeply etched in my memory is the Mungo experiment. You remember the two tin cans of plastic with soil, each planted with an equal number of mungo seeds? Procedurally, one was placed by the window or outside where it received direct sunlight, and the other one was placed in a shoebox indoors. I remember I placed mine under the stairs to make sure it was completely dark. Every day, we were made to observe and write down our observations in a table, measuring the plant and observing the color of the leaves. Now, after 1 week of these repeated activities, we came up with the results and conclusion that the presence of sunlight enables the plant to produce food via photosynthesis, which is essential to plant growth. This simple experiment illustrates what science is all about. It presents an objective methodology which includes the following: objective observation, measurement and data, possibly using or not necessarily using math as a tool, experiment and observation as benchmarks for testing this hypothesis, right? As we experimented in the mungo plant, the mungo seed, and then evidence as we measured the size of the plant and the color of the leaves as we observed. So induction, reasoning to establish general rules or conclusions drawn from facts or examples, and then repetition. So no matter how generational the repetition of the mungo experiment, we will get exactly the same results. When your grandchildren, great-grandchildren uses the mungo experiment in all its simple process, you will still yield the same results. And, of course, go through the same critical analysis, and this repetition will be verified and tested by critically exposing to scrutiny and peer assessment the results of this experiment. So science can be divided into different branches based on the subject of study. The natural sciences include physical sciences that study the inorganic world and comprise the fields of astronomy, physics, chemistry, and the earth sciences. The biological sciences, such as biology and medicine, study the organic world of life and its processes. Social sciences like anthropology, psychology, and economics study the social and cultural aspects of human behavior. Now, let us define religion. What is religion? Based on Attorney Malou's definition, religion is a set of fundamental beliefs and practices concerned with ultimate issues such as the nature of the divine, the origins of the universe, the meaning of human existence, how we should live our lives, whether there is a life after death, and salvation. Based on Encyclopedia Britannica, religion is a human being's relation to that which they regard as holy, sacred, absolute, spiritual, divine, or worthy of special reverence. It is also commonly regarded as consisting of the way people deal with ultimate concerns about their lives and their faith after death. In many religions, texts are deemed to have scriptural status, and people are esteemed to be invested with spiritual or moral authority. According to Attorney Malou, in her exposition or in her explanation of religion, there are many religions across the world, but on closer examination of the evidences presented, none comes close to Christianity. Not one of the other religions of this world has a Messiah who resurrected on the third day of his death so that all who believe in him may have eternal life. So now we move on to part two. So where then lies the conflict between Christian faith with science and reason? So based on the definitions that I gave you, there should be no conflict as reason and science deal with the material, physical, natural world, while religion operates on the spiritual and supernatural dimensions. However, I mentioned the development in the reason movement that spawned the birth of criticism against God and His existence. If you recall, I mentioned that there were quite a number of notable men in history who were non-religious, who put their trust in the scientific method, evidence, and reason to discover truths about the universe and placed human welfare and happiness at the center of their ethical decision-making. One of these gentlemen was Charles Darwin, an English naturalist whose scientific theory of evolution by natural selection became the foundation of modern evolutionary studies. An agnostic, Darwin suggested that animals and humans shared a common ancestry, which directly contradicted the creation story of the Christian Bible. So by discrediting the creation story, by saying that we all came from one common ancestor, all living things came from one ancestor, he would also disprove the existence of God. The theory of evolution makes statements about three different but related issues. The first one is the fact of evolution. That is that organisms are related by common descent. And two, evolutionary history, that details of when lineages split from one another and of the changes that occurred in each lineage. And three, the mechanisms or processes in which evolutionary change occurs. So let me explain that. The first one is it's a fact that there was evolution of organisms. But the second issue was, when did the split, when did these lineages split so that you have humans, you have different kinds of animals, right? And you have microorganisms. When did this organic life split up? And what were the changes that occurred in each lineage? And the third one, what were the processes, you know, that triggered these evolutionary changes? So the first issue is the most fundamental and the one established with utmost certainty. So Darwin gathered much evidence in its support, but evidence over the course of history, from the time Darwin thought about it, many scientists and many sciences have been discovered to affect the evolution of humanity or of organic life. So it has accumulated continuously over time, derived from other and from all biological disciplines. So the evolutionary origin of organisms is today a scientific conclusion, but it was established, not inspired by Darwin's theory of evolution, but not quite accurate. What was made accurate over time with a kind of certainty we have of it today because of other sciences, like the roundness of the earth, which is geology, the movement of the tectonic plates of the earth and how it's impacting on our lives, and the changes in our lives, the biological changes in our composition, and then the motions of the planets, and most of all, the most significant discovery is the molecular composition of matter, the most significant of which is the discovery of the DNA, the deoxyribonucleic acid. It's an intricate, delicate sequencing of protein molecules responsible for an organism's fundamental life processes. This degree of certainty beyond reasonable doubt is what is implied when biologists say today that evolution is a fact. The evolutionary origin of organisms is accepted by virtually every biologist as established by the confluence of principles from all biological disciplines. However, the theory of evolution goes far beyond the general affirmation that organisms evolve. The second and third issues, which I explained earlier, which seek to ascertain evolutionary relationships between particular organisms and the events of evolutionary history, as well as to explain how and why evolution takes place, are matters of active scientific investigation. So some conclusions are well established, but many matters are still left uncertain. Others are conjectural, and still others, such as the characteristics of the first living things and when they came about, remain completely unknown. Right? Now, if there's a theory of human evolution, there is also a theory of evolution for the universe, formulated by a Belgian priest, Georges Lemaître, who is also known as the astronomer and cosmologist, who formulated the Big Bang Theory. Now, what is this? The Big Bang Theory is stated or is defined or was formulated as such that it began, right, with a cataclysmic explosion of a small primeval super atom. All right? The theory says that the universe was born of the observation that other galaxies are actually moving away from our own at great speed, that this Big Bang, so this cataclysmic explosion of this primeval super atom, is also causing other galaxies moving farther away from us, from our galaxy, at a great speed in all directions, as if they were being propelled by an ancient explosive force. According to Michael Greshko and the National Geographic staff, even now, the universe is expanding. And to astronomers' surprise, the pace of expansion is accelerating, driven by a force that repels gravity called dark energy. We still don't know what dark energy is, but it's thought that it makes up 68% of the universe's total matter and energy. Dark matter makes up another 27%. In essence, all the matter you've ever seen, from your first love to the stars overhead, makes up less than 5% of the universe. Wow! How wow is that? Can you imagine what you're seeing with your eyes? What you are observing is only actually 5% of what is existing outside in the cosmos. So if you see, modern science from the beginning of the 20th century has actually been unable to disprove with certainty, beyond reasonable doubt, the existence of God. Modern science has not been able to establish why the universe came into existence, nor what preceded its birth through the Big Bang. Biological evolution, even with the discovery of the DNA, has not brought us the slightest clue of how the first living organisms emerged from inanimate matter, if the Big Bang model is indeed true. You know, an article in Time magazine authored by Amir Axel cites that even the DNA has not been able to explain one of the greatest mysteries of science. How did consciousness arise in living things? Where do symbolic thinking and self-awareness come from? What is it that allows us, humans, to understand the mysteries of biology, physics, mathematics, engineering, and medicine? And what enables man to create great works of art, music, architecture, and literature? Science is nowhere near to explaining these deep mysteries. And on the universe, why is it so precisely tailor-made for the emergence of life? This question has never been answered satisfactorily, let alone scientifically. You know, Axel continues to write, actually perturbed, in saying that why are even the tiniest particles of matter so unbelievably complicated? It appears that there is a vast hidden wisdom or structure or knotty blueprint for even the most simple-looking element of nature. And the situation becomes even more daunting as we expand our view to the entire cosmos. So now we go to the second source of conflict. And this, I came across a statement while going through Britannica and looking for the definition of reason. It states, the successful application of reason to any question depended on its correct application. So take note of that, that the application of reason to any question depended on its correct application. So influential humanists who were proponents of evidence-based reason on naturally occurring and observable phenomena brings to bear their outright rejection of the supernatural because of their ardent desire to obliterate God. There is almost an outright manipulation of the evidence because of a preconceived desire to eliminate the divine from their existence. So with himself as the central focus of this intellectual thought, man is able to expunge any moral limits to his desired behavior, be it good or bad. Take a look at Aldous Huxley, a 20th century humanist, an English novelist and critic, gifted with an acute and far-ranging intelligence. He was a grandson of the prominent biologist Thomas Henry Huxley, who was the author of the word agnosticism and an avid supporter of Charles Darwin's evolutionary naturalism. Huxley hailed from a renowned English family of scientists, artists, and literary geniuses. He was the third child of the biographer and man of letters Leonard Huxley, and his brothers included physiologist Andrew Fielding Huxley and biologist Julian Huxley. So this was indeed an illustrious family, an English family of letters, of literature, of science, and geniuses, actually. So let's look at what Aldous had to say about Christianity. For myself, as no doubt for most of my contemporaries, the philosophy of meaninglessness was essentially an instrument of liberation. The liberation we desired was simultaneously liberation from a certain political and economic system of morality. We objected to the morality because it interfered with our sexual freedom. I had motives for not wanting the world to have a meaning. Consequently, I assumed that it had none and was able without any difficulty to find satisfying reasons for this assumption. We don't know because we don't want to know. It is our will that decides how and upon what subjects we shall use our intelligence. This is the essence of agnosticism, not wanting to know because they don't want to know. All right, that's what agnosticism means. So they don't know God because they don't want to know him. They don't know of his existence because they exercise their will not to know his existence. That is agnosticism. And Aldous' statement actually highlights this worldview. Another modern-day humanist was British-born philosopher, logician, atheist, and social critic, best known for his work in mathematical logic and analytic philosophy, Bertrand Russell. In the public mind, he was famous as much as he was a philosopher for his evangelical atheism. Russell pioneered the demystification of religion at a time when people were being told that serious discussions about it required knowledge of Latin and church history. All right, so let me repeat that. He pioneered the demystification of religion. And this was at the time when people were told or people thought that serious discussions about religion, about faith, required Latin, a knowledge of Latin, and church history. So the result of this interpretation was twofold. The first one was many people came to understand that they were entitled to develop their own beliefs and views about religion. And second, arguments from church authority suddenly became less intimidating and less influential than it was for centuries. So Huxley and Russell made significant inroads in modern-day science and philosophy. However, they also exhibited the misguided use of reason for their own preconceived beliefs about God. This preconception is not just pervasive in the natural sciences, but equally in the social sciences, where historians, as according to Josh McDowell, a Christian apologist, you know, these historians approach history with a preconceived notion and then adjust the evidence accordingly. In other words, before they begin their historical examination, they have already determined the content of their results. He further adds that these presuppositions are actually philosophical biases, philosophical prejudices, and also the absence of metaphysical convictions. When we talk of metaphysics, metaphysics is actually what pertains to and is defined by Webster as a division of philosophy that is concerned with the fundamental nature of reality and being. It pertains to a study of what is outside objective experience and what cannot be reached through objective studies of material reality. These acts of non-religious historical influencers brings to mind Romans 3, verses 10 to 14, that looks into the natural inclination of men's hearts. It says, "There is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good. Not even one. Their throats are open graves. Their tongues practice deceit. The poison of vipers is on their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness." That's why the Bible expressly states that Christians should demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. And that every Christian should no longer conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed, but, you know, by the renewing of one's mind. Because reason can be deceptive when it is applied against the knowledge of God. You know, this is where the conflict lies. Not in reason, not in science, which have brought good into the world, but in the hearts of men who have tried to twist reason and pit science against Christian faith for their own selfish ends. Paul, in 1 Timothy 4, verses 1 and 2, prophetically elucidates this when he cited, "The Spirit clearly says that in later times, some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. Such teachings come through hypocritical liars whose consciences have been seared as with a hot iron." We now go to part 3. What is the verdict? Let me begin this answer with another question. And it goes this way. If science was not good, why would the Bible have simple allusions that have been scientifically proven centuries after the Word of God was written? In the Pentateuch, aside from creation and the Great Flood, which have been replicated in stories around the world, though with some variations, but essentially talking of similar occurrences, there are hygiene laws to prevent the spread of infectious diseases. Modern microbiology and epidemiology has allowed us to understand their scientific basis. Take a look at this. In Leviticus 11, we have a discourse on healthy meats and decaying animals. And then Leviticus 12 talks about post-childbirth care. In Leviticus 13, it talks about skin diseases and what to do with them and what should be avoided. And then Leviticus 14, verses 33 to 53, talks about household molds. Leviticus 15 talks about bodily discharges. And Deuteronomy 23 talks about community sanitation. And Numbers 19 talks about the importance of running water. Now, regarding the cosmos, take a look at this. You know, this is really amazing. And I've put in the scientific fact, what the Bible verse is, and who is credited with the authorship or discovery in science, in modern science, or centuries after the Bible quoted these verses, or had these verses, wrote these verses. The first one is, the earth is a sphere. The Bible verse is Isaiah 40, verse 22, which was wrote. Isaiah was wrote sometime 700 BC. He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth. And the scientific authorship of the world being a sphere is credited to the ancient Greeks. There's Pythagoras sometime in 500 BC, which was then established by Aristotle in 350 BC. The other one is the earth floats in space. Job 26, verse 7 says, he spreads out the northern skies over empty space. He suspends the earth over nothing. And Job is said to have been written 2 millennials before Christ was born. Okay, and scientific authorship now about earth floating into space is credited to Nicholas Copernicus in 1500 A.D., so that's almost three and a half millennia after, right, that Job, that the Bible writes or the scripture writes that the earth floats in space. How about the universe is expanding? In Isaiah 42:5, this is what God the Lord says, the creator of the heavens who stretches them out. And again, Isaiah was written sometime 700 BC. And when was this talked about? That the universe is expanding. Remember the Big Bang theory of the multiverses, or Big Bang theory. It also has an offshoot theory of multiverses, multiple universes, right? That's going farther and farther away from our own universe. And this was discovered sometime in the mid-1900s AD. And this one, individual stars are unique. In 1 Corinthians 15:41, says the sun has one kind of splendor, the moon another, and the stars another, and star differs from star in splendor. And this is in 1 Corinthians 5. And again, in 1900, again, mid-20th century, you have again the Big Bang theory of multiverses, which gets the credit for the individual stars being unique. And the last one is the earth and the human body share common building blocks. And we have this in Genesis 2, verse 7, when the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground. And when was this established? The DNA discovery in 1950 AD. Amazing, right? So in conclusion, I could not have worded this any better than what the U.S. National Academies of Science, Engineering and Medicine have stated as. Science and religion are based on different aspects of human experience. In science, explanations must be based on evidence drawn from examining the natural world. Religious faith, in contrast, does not depend only on empirical evidence, is not necessarily modified in the face of conflicting evidence, and typically involves supernatural forces or entities. Because they are not a part of nature, supernatural entities cannot be investigated by science. In this sense, science and religion are separate and address aspects of human understanding in different ways. Attempts to pit science and religion against each other create controversy where none needs to exist. Now, as for reason, let me ask you some questions here. is it not akin to intellect, which outside of the human species, none of the other creative beings possess? Is reason not akin to the accumulation of knowledge to understand and explain man's existence in relation to the world around him and above all, most of all, in relation to the one who created him? And is reason not akin to wisdom when it is used to understand life from God's perspective? You know, Proverbs 1 verse 7 says, "The fear of the Lord is a beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction." And in Proverbs 9:10, it says, "The fear of the Lord is a beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding." Indeed, knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Understanding the intricacies and balance between naturally occurring phenomena and that which science cannot explain. Even Albert Einstein, generally considered to be the most influential physicist, if not the greatest, of the 20th century, has this to say. He clarified his religious views, stating that he believed that there was an old one who was the ultimate lawgiver. He would write, "I'm not an atheist, and I don't think I can call myself a pantheist. We are in the position of a little child entering a huge library filled with books in many different languages. The child dimly suspects a mysterious order in the arrangement of the books, but doesn't know what it is. That, it seems to me, is the attitude of even the most intelligent human being toward God." As I end, I have to share with you that as I was preparing this message, I realized that we know so little of God and His creation. The more man tries to discover, the more he will find out. And the more we find out, we know nothing. You know, what our five senses see is nothing compared to the infiniteness of cosmic space, nor the intricate weaving of subatomic particles that are composite parts of human life and all created things. Now, tell me, how awesome is that? You know, God said in Isaiah 40, verses 25 to 26, "To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls them by name, each of them by name, because of his great power and mighty strength. Not one of them is missing." God created science when he created the universe. God breathed reason and gave it to man when he created man in his own image and likeness. And everything that God created was good, very good. It was man and the evil in man's heart that corrupted what God created as good. Jesus himself said in Mark 7, verses 21 to 23, "For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person." So ladies, next time someone asks you, "Is Christian faith compatible with science and reason?" The answer is a resounding yes. How can it be otherwise when God created them all? So now, ladies, let us pray and give back all the glory to our God, our divine creator. Lord, thank you. Thank you so much for putting this message together. Lord, we are nothing. Man is nothing compared to who you are. You have accorded us yet your favor by sending Jesus to save us from our wicked inclinations, Lord. We are nothing, yet you have given us this favor. So, Lord, please, may we return this favor. We entreat you to help us to return this favor with our devoted worship of you. And may we never go our own way or never go apart from your presence. Lord, apart from you, we truly are nothing. And this I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we thank you for joining us this morning. But before you go, our next speaker is Attorney Malu Mendoza, who will synthesize this series by talking about worldview, but this time from a godly perspective, God's perspective. So mark your calendar, September 22, for the conclusion of our apologetic series, focusing on God's view of the world. But meantime, while waiting with great expectation for the end of our apologetic series, don't forget to meet, to generate even more insights on God, our Creator, with the following discussion questions. 1. How has science helped you in your daily life? 2. Why is reason a gift from God? Name instances in your life when you used the gift of reason. And last, why would you say science and reason are compatible with Christian faith? When is it not? By citing some examples. So thank you, ladies, and have a blessed day.